Hey everyone, Austin here again with another Let's Play video. Today it's going to be the adventures of Batman and Robin for the Sega Genesis. Now, this is something I'm going to be doing more frequently lately, is Let's Plays I have already done before. Adventures of Batman and Robin was actually one of the first Let's Plays I ever did, I think back in 2011-ish, I believe. Maybe 2012. What I want to do is go back and re-record a lot of those old Let's Plays because I had a much more archaic video hardware setup back then. I've gotten better as a player, and my subscriber base has, I think, more than doubled since. So I'd be introducing new people to some of these games I've already played that they might have missed out on in the past. So what you guys are going to see me doing over the coming months, and well, probably over the coming years, because I don't think I'm going to be able to pump these out that quickly, is revisitations of old games I've already played in the Let's Play format. So Adventures of Batman and Robin is a really, really fun game and a really technically impressive game on the system, on the Sega Genesis. It's basically a side-scrolling sort of like beat-em-up slash run-and-gun. It's kind of like a hybrid of the two because you can shoot kind of like this, but you can also like jump kick and you can punch guys. When you get close and you do your attack, Batman and Robin will basically punch. So it's kind of like a hybrid of the two genres. Think of it as like Gunstar Heroes meets Streets of Rage or something like that. And the gameplay is definitely more heavily focused on the Contra or Gunstar Heroes versus the Streets of Rage, but there is definitely a little bit of, you know, beat-em-up action in here in that regard. There's even some shmup action as well, some shoot-em-up action, which we're going to see later on in the game. It's actually one of the longest sections in the game, and you guys will definitely know what it is once I get there. So, you know, I actually just played this on stream on YouTube last week as of recording this, and so hopefully not too many of you guys watched that stream. I was actually going to do I was going to start with the NES doing these old Let's Play replays. I was going to do Castlevania on the NES, and I brought my retro USB AVS system into my game room, and the USB port snapped off when I tried plugging the console in. So basically what the AVS does is it uses the USB connection for power, and unfortunately it's kind of a poor design, and it's very flimsy, and so it just snapped off completely, turning my AVS into an AV brick. And so I had to figure out on the fly, like, oh great, what am I going to do now? I was planning on doing NES, but that's not going to work. So fortunately, I still had my Genesis out from last week's stream, and I figured, okay, you know, went through my old Let's Play lists, and I saw that Batman and Robin was one of the very first I ever did. And so I figured, you know what, why not start from the beginning, basically, or close to it. So in Batman and Robin, you have three different types of firepower. You basically have red, blue, and green. So what I did is I just picked up the red power up, which is sort of like these little mini boomerangs. They go out in a spread fashion. They can go up to a three-way shot as they get powered up. It's actually the weapon I recommend using the most for general gameplay because there's generally a lot of enemies on screen in this game. And the red shot, especially once you get it up to a three-way, is extremely useful, and it's fairly powerful too once you get it maxed out. The green power-up is this sort of like ball and chain. I don't know what the actual name for the real-life weapon is. But it basically is just like this one big circular attack that just goes across the screen. It's like more of a dedicated attack that's just very powerful. And I'm not focusing here. I keep picking up the wrong firepower. I need to focus on my health too and make sure I'm picking up lots of hearts along the way. Enemies will sometimes drop hearts on this first level. Sometimes you'll get hearts out of trash cans. And your health meter is actually in the top left-hand portion of the screen. And there's some hearts right there. Your health meter is in the top left-hand portion of the screen. And actually, I just died. That's horrible. I should just reset. I'd never die in this first level. So that's actually a really bad show of play. Here I am in the very beginning, like, oh, I'm going to redo these Let's Plays because I've gotten so much better as a player, yet I die in the first level. But that's what happens when you've got a whole lot else on your mind, like your AVS system breaking on you, and you having to try to figure out what to do next. So on boss fights, if you're actually low on firepower, the boss fights will actually drop you some firepower, so you're not at your lowest level when you're fighting these bosses. If you are at your lowest level when you're fighting these bosses, I recommend trying to use your punch attack as much as possible, because it's more powerful than your not powered up attacks. Let's get up and punch this dude. Now, Adventures of Batman and Robin is generally seen as being a fairly difficult game. I think it is a challenging game to learn, but I don't think once you know it, it's that challenging to play. And that's one of the great things about the game, I feel, is that, yes, there is a learning curve to the game, but it's very satisfying once you do actually learn the game. You should be able to just fly right through this game, and it's just a lot of fun to play. Not only is it fun to play, but it's also fun to look at. There's a lot of creativity in the boss fights, and it just... That's sort of like it's amplified later on in the game as we get to later bosses in the game. But I mean, the game's a ton of fun. It is definitely a challenge at first. The game does require some discipline, even if you're familiar with the game. You will still have to make sure you're doing things right, not playing stupid, just like any good, you know, not super hard game, but, you know, moderately challenging game. You do have to still play smart. So now, normally I'm a lot more aggressive on these boss fights, but because I died and I lost all my firepower, and when you die in this game, you don't lose all your firepower right away. It usually just downgrades you by one level. But one of the problems I had when I was playing the very early parts of this stage was picking up different colored power-ups. Now, in order to power up your weapons, you have to pick up the same color in order to actually upgrade your weapon. If you pick a different color, it'll just switch you to the same level of a different weapon. So, even though I was changing weapons, I wasn't actually upgrading my weapons, which was a major problem. And what I actually want to do is definitely switch from this this blue attack. These are like little shurikens or something like that, and they're not powerful at all. It's the weakest weapon in the game. It also has a three-way spread shot, but I just don't find it very useful at all because it's weaker than the other one. So now I've got a three-way shot. I'm going to switch over to the green one. So Batman and Robin has a bunch of forced sections where the screen stops scrolling. You have to take on a bunch of enemies in an enclosed room, basically. Or it feels enclosed because the screen's not moving. But there are other parts like this where the screen does move. And you could sort of just take those parts as fast as you can. We're going to switch back over to the red power-up, actually. Okay, so we're not maxed out yet. You could tell how there's one really large, like, Batarang. But then you have, like, the two little rinky-dink ones next to it. That means you're not powered up yet. You're not fully powered up. So we still have another level or two to go to get our red shot maxed out. Or our firepower in general maxed out. Now, I'm still taking a lot of hits. So we'll see how we can do here. A lot of times, these floating guys that come in, they drop health whenever you destroy them. So what you can do is actually just sit on this screen, and a lot of times they'll just, you know, spawn in infinitely, and you can pretty much just grind out on health to your heart's content. See, just like this. And that's exactly what I'm gonna do right now, actually. Let's see if they fly in again. No. They're not, it doesn't look like they do it on this screen. They constantly come in as you scroll the screen. Now, right before this boss fight, they do constantly spawn in, just over and over and over again. Whether you're scrolling the screen or not. Okay, there we go. Health is pretty good. Let's let this switch over to red. Now, later on in the game, you're going to encounter those weapon power-ups, and they don't actually scroll. So you're going to either be forced to pick up a red one, or a green one, or whatever. And in those situations, it's okay to just jump over them and pass them. In the early parts of the game, though, when they're constantly scrolling through, cycling through, you want to just wait and pick up the one that you need. Because Batman and Robin is a lot easier the faster you get your firepower up. And that's basically going to be my goal here, is to get fully powered up. Normally, I'm like fully powered up or close to it on the first level alone. But since I was sort of not really paying attention, that didn't happen, and then I ended up dying, which set me back even farther. Almost a square one, actually, in terms of my firepower. Alright, so let's sit down here. On this part, only the green ones come down. Now, do they constantly come out? Okay, maybe they don't constantly come out. Maybe it is only they come out when the screen scrolls. So, yeah, the second I start scrolling the screen, they come back out. I was under the impression that they just constantly respawn over and over. But still, it's really good to know that they do come out as you scroll the screen, because they drop health. And it's really good to know what enemies drop health in this game, so you can get your health back. You're probably going to need to get your health back multiple times throughout this game. It's, like I said, it can be a challenging game. And if you're not playing discipline, and if you don't know the, you know, the stage layouts and enemy progression and whatnot, and in particular the boss patterns, you're gonna lose lots of health, and you're gonna need to regain that health if at all possible. Now, fortunately, you do get some continues in Batman and Robin, but what I found is that, especially later on in the game, is if you have to continue, you basically start with no firepower. And you have minimal amount of lives. You can earn extra lives throughout the course of the game through extra life pickups. And that can help you get through the game as well by having a larger buffer of lives. But when you continue, you go right back down to the default 2 lives or whatever. You're downgraded to the weakest firepower there is. And in the later parts of the game, and this actually happened on my live stream because I wasn't really paying attention while I was playing, I got a game over on the final level and had to start the level from scratch with no power-ups. And it was pretty much impossible to recover at that point. So yeah, like I said, basically my goal is going to be to try to get powered up, collect all the heart icons I can, and hopefully we'll make it through the game. Hopefully we'll make it through without continuing. No guarantees, especially since I lost a life already. Which again, is kind of sad. I mean, my original Let's Play of this game, I think I might have done it. I think I might have beat the game without continuing, and that was a long time ago. And I think I just busted the game out of, like, nowhere. I didn't practice it or anything. So kind of a good Let's Play in that regard. Okay, it looks like these guys are constantly spawning, but they don't drop any health, unfortunately. Oh, and more come in, too. There we go. So sometimes you'll pick up some big hearts on the playfield, and that's a lot of health, typically. Let me try to grab that power-up. What that power-up does is it instantly charges your charge meter. Now, you do have a charge meter in the game. You can charge up your attacks. A lot of times what'll happen is they'll sort of cut through enemies. Your attack will cut through enemies much more efficiently. It's actually not that much more powerful, though, which is kind of interesting. If you use it on a boss, you'll notice that the boss health doesn't really drop all that much when you use your charge attack. So it's not really worth using your charge attack on a boss fight. A lot of times it's better to just constantly rapid fire as much as you can. Alright, this is the boss. We're gonna be fighting the Joker. And so boss fights in this game, like I said, it's pretty much all about memorizing the patterns, learning the patterns. So the Joker, he does this attack where he slides all the way across the screen. He'll do it again, like so. He'll do one where he goes down to the bottom left, just like so. Now he's going to do one where he goes down to the middle. Now he's going to do one where he goes down to the bottom right. So it's all about knowing how the bosses work in this game in order to defeat them successfully. I think he's going to start jumping over. Yep, just kind of like that. So the green weapon is the most powerful weapon in the game. But the downside to it is that it's not a spread shot. It does still take up a good chunk of screen space, though, fortunately. Oops. You can actually tell where the Joker's going by his arm movements. And that's basically the first level down. Batman and Robin has four, I guess you can call them acts, which are a series of stages back to back, culminating in one large boss fight in the end. Or level, technically, I guess is what they call them. So that was level one, all those little stages we played through. Now, level two actually features the shoot-em-up section, which is one of the longest portions of the game, one of the most monotonous portions of the game. And that's one of the downsides of Batman and Robin, is that it definitely has some repetition to it. As much as I like this game, there are some really genuinely boring parts to it. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go ahead and just keep this weapon, because it's really powerful. Like, why not? I'm just going to hold on to it. And this is actually how I used to play when I was a kid. Playing this game. I actually bought this game probably, must have been like 96-ish, maybe 97. I guess I was a teenager at that time. When a lot of Genesis games were being liquidated for about 10 bucks a pop. You know, Genesis was still on the market technically, but it was on its way out. Many of the games were being discounted. And Batman and Robin is technically a fairly late Genesis release. I believe it came out in 1995. And so just a year or two later, you know, you could find it in stores for 10 bucks brand new. And that's how I got my copy back in the day. I actually played it at a friend's house, though, before I got the game. Pretty sure I played it at a friend's house. And so that's actually kind of what got me, much like Contra Hardcore, I actually played that at a friend's house, too. That's what got me interested in the game. And then when I saw it for cheap, I was like, I have to buy this, and I did. I had a ton of fun with it. But despite liking it a lot, there are still lots of repetitious sections. Even back in the day, I knew that like a lot of the game was just very repetitive and monotonous in nature. But still, it's still a game I highly recommend checking out. What I do find, though, is that as you get better at the game, some of the repetitious sections don't really stick out as much because you learn how to get through them a little bit faster. You start playing better, you start playing faster. Myself, personally, when I get good at a game, or when I personally feel I'm quote-unquote good at a game, I start, you know, slicing and dicing my way through enemies faster than I ever would have when I first, you know, play the game for the first time. And that's a really satisfying experience for me with these classic action platformers and so forth, is getting good to the point where you can just tear through the game really, really quickly. That's the sort of feeling I get when I play like Castlevania or something like that. Or even a Contra game, or Gunstar Heroes, is even in the repetitious sections, you know, I can still tear through them pretty quickly to where I don't notice the repetition. Not that Castlevania really has repetition. You know, it's such a well-made game in my opinion. But Batman and Robin does, but even the most repetitious sections in the game, I can sort of just gloss over because I get through them quickly and efficiently. But yeah, you guys will see what I mean by repetitious in nature after this level. I mean, you can even tell this level. There's just a lot of the same things going on over and over. Technically, the level probably could have ended, you know, half a level ago, basically. But we're at the boss fight now, so no more need to complain. So this is basically revolving around Two-Face. We do actually see Two-Face here. I think it's actually the only time in this episode we actually see Two-Face. Now, when you're fighting this boss, it's best to just try to take out one turret at a time. I do find it to be a little bit quicker if you're using the spread shot, the red spread shot, or the orange spread shot. Sorry, it's not red. And you're attacking one of those turrets with every single shot. Sort of like point-blanking the enemy, basically, as they call it in shmup's terms. So in this part right here, Two-Face basically drops dynamite in a very similar fashion to what he does throughout the stage. But he also drops large, like, bundles of dynamite. And when he does that, the whole screen, like, scrolls down a little bit, and a ball of fire goes across the floor. In those cases, you just need to sit on one side and then jump over them. Now, something I forgot to mention is when you jump kick in the game, by pressing jump in the air again, Batman and Robin, they'll do jump kicks. And that actually gives you a little bit of extra clearance. You basically like jump up, you basically do like a little form of a double jump in a way, but it also acts as an attack. And so you can use it both to attack enemies, but you can also use it to double jump over platforms or gaps or obstacles a little bit easier. Oops, I didn't want to switch to this. What we're going to do is we're going to try to switch back to the spread shot again, the red spread shot. You can see how weak like this blue attack is. It's just not good at all. It seems to be okay when you've got, you know, your charge attack going in rapid succession. Like I picked up the power up that lets me charge my attack faster. So that's useful on this level in particular, but the blue power-up on its own is just not very good at all. You can just really see how weak it is. It's really surprising to me that they left it as a three-way shot, because it's just completely redundant. They should have made it a five-way shot, I feel, if the game could have handled it. I'm sure it could have. There's so much other crap going on screen. You know, that would have like balanced out the fact that it's weaker than the red shot, which is also a three-way shot. So I'm surprised that they didn't really catch on to that in development. It's just a really redundant item, and definitely not worth picking up compared to the red or green power-ups. So this is the shmup section I was talking about, the side-scrolling shoot-em-up section. Very monotonous. All these enemies you're going to see me taking out, we're pretty much going to be taken out for like the entirety of this whole section. There are a couple of like mini bosses and so forth. And some of the larger enemies, you can try to take them out faster, like I said. You know, the more efficient you get at it, the faster you can tear through these sections, and the less monotonous it feels. The background does change a little bit. These green planes right here, they're like sort of like mini boss fights, not really. They are larger enemies. You do have to take them out before new enemies will spawn in. There's usually a few of them back to back. These smaller, like, biplane formations, you can usually cut through them with a charge attack. We're gonna go ahead and switch over to the green and see how that does. You can see how the green is actually quite powerful. It kills these guys in one or two hits. The only unfortunate thing is, like I said, it's not a spread shot, but it is more of, like, the focused shot in the game. And as such, it's the most powerful. Which is fine if you're just attacking a single enemy at a time, but on this section in particular, a lot of times you're fighting multiple enemies. Like, there's multiple missiles now, so it's definitely better for me to be using the red spread shot right now. I'm just gonna call it the red spread. I know it's orange, but, you know, whatever. Alright, there we go. We picked it back up. I think it'll be more useful for the rest of this stage. In particular, the boss fight. The boss fight is a series of turrets. And then a massive helicopter itself, and as you're moving around these turrets, I find that the red shot is just more useful, because you can still actually hit the boss's turrets as you're dodging, whereas with the green shot, you've got to be right in front of the turret, you know, lined up with it in order to make a shot hit. But with the red shot, you can be off to the side a little bit and still make contact, still do some damage. You guys will see what I mean once we get to that point in the game. And, so this is one of the mini-bosses. Basically what you do is you shoot off both of his turrets, and then he starts bum-rushing you like crazy. He does a ton of damage when he hits you. So you want to just rush out of the way, if you can. Just try to keep a good eye out on his movements, and you can sort of have an idea of, you know, where he's gonna go. You definitely don't want him to corner you. And since I've already lost, a life... Ow. So yeah, that just took off a huge chunk of my health. But fortunately, when you defeat bosses on these levels, this shmup level, typically they drop lots of hearts as well. So there is a way to recoup your energy, fortunately. Yeah, and you can really tell how the red shot is still weak in comparison to the green shot. And here we go with the background change. There's going to be a lot of clouds. We're going to go through a clouded section. And then we're going to go and fight this massive battleship, which is a pretty cool section of this level. But everything leading up to the battleship, though, just kind of drags on and drags on. This is usually... You know, when it comes to repetition, this is usually the major point of contention for people that play this game. They're like, man, that shooter section just goes on for way too long. And it really does. If they mixed up the gameplay more, I think it would be different. I think the gameplay is actually solid, but, you know, there's bullets you have to dodge and things like that. But it's just the same types of enemies over and over and over again. With very little variation. So we got some skulls here. The skulls are screen clearing bombs, basically. You can see how the screen rumbles and clears off enemies on screen, which is nice. So if you see these, a lot of times what I'll do is I'll wait until they're about to pass off the screen and then use them. That way I can basically clear as many enemies as I possibly can. Okay, I got the charge attack. Let's go ahead and use it on this guy. There's gonna be a couple of these fighter jets or whatever the hell you want to call them. Now, despite this section going on for way too long, it is an indicator of how long or how far you are into the game. So we're about 30 minutes into this Let's Play, and we're almost halfway through the game. So, you know, time still does fly when you're playing this game. But as you can see, it still gets repetitive. Look at all these very samey missiles we're attacking over and over and over again. And they're not very, like, satisfying enemies to take down either. You know, it's not like they're challenging. It's not like there's really a good, you know, impactful feeling you get when you destroy them. You don't really get that. And back to more helicopters, basically. Now, the boss fight itself, funny enough, is just a massive helicopter, but it's actually pretty cool. I do like the graphical effects on this boss fight. The graphical effects on most boss fights in this game, actually, are pretty awesome. Either from huge, huge sprites, like in the case of the Joker, to just really cool other visual effects that are pulled off, like lighting effects and things like that, or just some really smooth animation. Alright, we should be close to the battleship now. Hopefully that is the case. Well, not hopefully. Well, yeah, hopefully, but I know it's definitely the case. We're pretty close. I ended up picking up the green power-up, which I didn't want to do, but it's okay. I'll just hold on to it. Switch back over to the red. Oh, the patterns just keep coming. It's the same thing over and over. Ugh. I don't know, maybe the devs thought back in the day, like, oh no, our game might be too short, we need to pad out sections. And I know certain developers probably actually thought that with their games. I'm not sure if these developers with Batman and Robin thought that, but it does make you scratch your head and wonder as you play this game, especially when you're doing a Let's Play like this, where you're a little bit analytical about the situation at the same time, you know. These flaws rear their ugly head a little bit easier when you're playing like that. I don't recommend playing analytically when you're playing video games. You should play video games for fun. But when you're doing a series like this, it's kind of hard not to sometimes. Alright, a couple more of these guys, and I think we're at the battleship. So let me do what they call point blanking, where basically all of your spread shots hit the enemy. Because you're attacking really, really close to the enemy. And thus, you're doing way more damage rapidly. But it's riskier because you have to be up close. And Batman and Robin does not allow you to, you know, rapidly attack faster or anything like that. Gotta get up close to this guy again. I took way too long to kill that first one, so much so that the second one came on screen when that's not really supposed to happen. But it will if you're too slow at attacking enemies. That's the other thing where being efficient at this game is pretty important for survival. Because the less efficient you are, the more enemies will start, you know, snowballing on screen, basically. So the faster you can take out enemies, the more manageable the whole experience is. So this whole battleship is going to be a series of turrets. You've got these missile-flinging turrets. You've got these little rinky-dink turrets on the sides. They shoot those colored bullets out at you. You've got these turrets, they shoot, you know, these blue attacks. And then you've got these satellite-looking turrets, which shoot these, sort of like ring lasers out at you. And this is what I was talking about earlier, where when you have the spread shot, you can dodge the main, satellite turret laser, but still hit the turret at the same time, because you're using your spread shot. And now, you're not timed in Batman and Robin, so there's really no need to, like, rush through these boss fights. Something to keep in mind when you're playing this game. So you can try to, like, dodge these attacks, really as much as you can, and as slowly as you can. You can just sit back and take your time. What I really want to do is kill this turret so I can get some health back. There we go. Got it. But the satellite turret's probably going to drop me some health, too. Yep. Lots of little health icons. That guy seems like he's doing just whatever the hell he wants. Normally they kind of like lock onto you and just shoot wherever you are. But some of these satellite turrets will just sort of do their own thing and just attack anywhere. So you really gotta watch out for where they're pointed, what direction they're pointed in. extra life right here. It's good, we got our lives back up. Now we're gonna definitely burn through some on the next stage. So we've gotta be very, very careful still. Okay, this is actually the last turret, section of turrets, before we go to the actual boss fight itself. I'm taking a lot of damage here. We got some of that back, that's good. Got all of it back, actually. So taking out these missile turrets, it's good to have your attack charged up and just wait for them to open. Bam, just like that. Now if I can, I'd rather take out the missile turret first just to make life a little bit easier here. You can just kind of see how I'm just circling around over and over. There we go, we got it. Got my health back too. I could probably just tank here, actually. Yeah, because I figured I'd get some health back. He was down to like 14 health. And it seems like doing your fully charged attack up close does about a 4 to 5 damage. You know, so when you get to a boss fight, they basically have 99 hit points. And every certain amount of hits will take away a hit point. But charge attacks, especially up close with the red shot, will dish out much more damage, like 4 or 5 at once. So like, when I was talking about like the cool graphical effects on bosses, like on this boss in particular, it's like this spot lamp effect, which is really cool. It'll change colors over the course of the boss fight. He's almost dead. And that's it. Alright, so we're officially halfway through the game now. We're at the 40-minute mark. I believe my original Let's Play of this was about... I think it was about an hour and 15 minutes or so. So it makes sense that we've got about another, you know, 35 to 40 minutes of gameplay. So in this level, you can just try to keep moving forward until you get locked into forced fights, basically. Which, this is one of those sections right here. So in this level, they like to throw out a lot of these boxes, and they basically spawn out a lot of these, like, little gnome enemies. Gnomes are going to be a reoccurring theme on this stage. Alright, so whenever it says go, you can go. And on these sections, I just like to keep pushing forward as much as I can until we get to a forced fight, basically. And that's how you can get through these sections a lot faster. If you focus on the enemy, you'll get more points, but, you know, points, it's more just like a bragging rights sort of thing. Like, oh, I got a high score. The game does not save your high scores. So, I don't really think about points in this game. I don't even know if you actually get extra lives from points in this game. I've never noticed if I did. I don't think you do. I think you only get extra lives in this game from item pickups. Now, if anybody knows to the contrary, you know, if you do actually get extra lives from points, let me know in the comment section below, and let me know what those point thresholds are. I'm actually kind of curious. You've also got these rabbits. They basically explode near you. You want to be as far away from them as you can. Now, these sort of like orangish guys up top, they're actually good to take out, because they'll give you power-ups and so forth. A lot of times they'll give you health. So if you're low on health or something like that, you definitely want to take these guys out. A lot of times what I do is I just sort of, I move to the right, and then I take them out as I go, kind of like this. Oops. Yeah, we got a little bit of health back at least. Oh, I missed a heart. Yeah, that would have given me pretty much all my health back. Alright, that's it. So on to our first boss in this, this level. And any of you guys that I've ever read or seen Alice in Wonderland, you will recognize this boss. One of the coolest boss fights in the game. Also one of the most dangerous in the game. He does a lot of damage. But just like everything else in the game, it's very patternistic. So whenever he smashes down on the ground, he basically makes, ceiling lamps fall down. They do a lot of damage if they touch you. So in terms of attacking, I recommend if you're just kind of jumping up like this, you'll constantly point blank him with your three-way shot. This is actually one of the more grueling boss fights in the game, because he's just a very high level of defense. It takes a lot of hits to actually take away some energy from him. So what I used to do as a kid is just jump kick like this, but it's still really, really slow. So I found out that if you have a powered up three-way shot, you can take away his life much faster. Okay, still have a little less than health, half my health left. Alright, we got this. And that's it. Alright, so for this last part, you need to just get over to one side of the screen. That will do damage if it hits you. But really cool graphical effect, too. Alright, so we got all our health back, that's good. This section of the game is pretty tough. There's gonna be some tough platforming here, actually. If you fall down to the bottom of the screen, you don't die instantly, but you do lose a lot of health. And, Batman gets flung right back up to the top of the screen. Interesting to know that the Skull Bomb actually doesn't kill those boxes in one hit. I thought it would. Which is why I went and I grabbed it. Oh, that was close. Alright, now you have these things to deal with. You need to basically do your double jump over them. And the timing is very tight on some of them. Oh, they knocked me down. Though they knocked me down again. And again! See, if you could probably tell, you can actually die really, really quickly on this section. Which makes it one of the more challenging parts of the game, actually. And they knocked me down again. Get a little bit of health. Hopefully there's gonna be more health here. There we go. That's one of the tougher ones right there, too. As is this. So is that. It really requires you to get good with your double jumps. And actually, I just realized when you die in this game, it actually looks like you get downgraded by more than just one level. It's like two or three levels. So, they actually do punish you quite a bit for dying. Alright, I think that's it. Unfortunately, there's not much in the way of health right now. So we're potentially lose another life. I'm not powered up, so. There we go. At least there's an extra life. Alright, this part's a little tricky. You've got all these little gnome dudes that bust out of the back. And you really gotta keep an eye out for where they're popping out from. They basically just home in straight for you. It's actually very hard in the eye. It's very difficult to see where they're actually spawning from. Wow, did it without taking a lot of damage. Alright, so the boss is gonna come down from the left. And he basically just hops around like a bumbling idiot. And you just want to make sure you don't get crushed. Got him. Are they gonna refill our health? Hopefully. Yes, they do. Awesome. Alright, let's get powered up again. Alright, very good. I think one more should do it, and we'll be powered up fully again. Yeah, so they actually punish you more than I remembered for dying, in terms of, like, power-up loss. Another section where there's some really cool background effects. I mean, that's one of the things that kind of keeps me from knocking Batman and Robin too much when it comes to the repetition, is that it's got some really, really, really damn good graphics for the Sega Genesis. You know, you could tell they're really doing stuff with the hardware that a lot of developers didn't do, and it's impressive to look at. You know, if you played a lot of the Genesis library, you'll know that not a lot of games had graphical effects like this. There's definitely some major standout titles that do, but it was the exception to the rule back in the day. So it's definitely a joy going back to this game, if only for the graphical effects. I mean, the gameplay is still a lot of fun too, but like I said earlier on in the Let's Play, it can get monotonous, it can get repetitive. Alright, so after this section, we're actually on the final stretch, and then we're going to fight the Mad Hatter himself in what's it definitely is the coolest boss fight in the game. From a graphical perspective and just a general what you have to do perspective, anyway. I think when people think of this game, they usually think of that boss fight. And the music that plays in the background is just, it makes it feel like a very aggressive sort of experience, which is very cool. Alright, so we have to be careful here. Last time I got here, it was actually on the stream, was I just got wrecked on this part. I think mostly because I wasn't really paying attention, but you can get destroyed pretty quickly on this section. Just like you can on most of this stage, level 3. I'm gonna go ahead and take this, the green shot, see if that helps us here. Alright, good. Got a lot of health back. That's good. Alright, we're gonna switch back over to the three-way shot. Yeah, for some of these enemies, I feel like I'm just experimenting. And as strong as the green shot is, it really actually feels like the red shot is the way to go if you're getting up close. It feels like it's the best shot when you're up close. But it also has the benefit of spreading out at a distance. So it gives you more leverage on enemies far away as well. Particularly the enemies that are like, sort of like what would be classified as popcorn enemies and like a shoot 'em up. You know, enemies that pretty much die in one hit. You can just, there's usually a lot of them. You can slice through them in one hit really quickly. Alright, so we're going to try to attack the Mad Hatter as much as we possibly can while he's still actually on screen. So we can try to kill him as quickly as possible. Otherwise, this level actually goes on for quite some time. And it actually becomes more difficult the longer it goes. You can see that there's these Mad Hatter stand-ups or dominoes, sort of, in the background. And they do damage to you. And this whole section gets faster and faster and faster. There's more devious and more devious patterns the longer you go. So it's recommended being powered up here and trying to take out this guy as fast as possible. And he's actually very low on health already. Ooh, he's very, very low on health. That's good. So now we're going to basically just go through this automated section. I'm automated as in, you know, the game's just scrolling for me. I'm still moving. I'm still playing. Now you can actually just either, you know, try to position yourself to go through the gaps, or you can try to, you know, you can double jump over the walls. So this is the last part, actually. We actually had a really good fight. I need to get away and not die. Oh, we just died. We just killed him, too. It's okay. If we get back up, there's going to be an extra life opportunity right here. You can hit his hat, which makes an extra life appear. But it's a shame that we ended up dying right as we killed him because of the exploding bunny. So, all right. This is a tough level, and this is a bit of a grind as well. Hopefully, we can do this without being fully powered up right from the beginning. These little droids that come at you, they also explode. And here we go, we got some power-ups that do not change colors. So it makes it harder to power up. Look, these are just blue power-ups, and you know the blue one is my least favorite. I really don't want one. Blue power-up? No, thank you. I will pass. And it seems like those little droids have a tendency of never giving you, like, anything worthwhile. They don't... Actually, I don't even know if they drop anything in terms of pickups. Yeah, and this is why dying at the Mad Hatter actually hurt me the most, is now I'm pretty much completely powered down. Which is gonna make my life total hell for the rest of the game. We're gonna die again. Yep, just died again. That sucks. This level, this section in particular is a major pain if you're not powered up. And that's exactly what I was worried about getting here, is I wanted to make sure I was gonna be powered up when I got here, but I failed to do so. Because I died at the Mad Hatter boss. Is this it yet? Please tell me this is it. This is going on forever. Alright, hopefully this isn't as bad now that we're not dealing with like those little robots as much. I think we still have to deal with them, but not to the same extent. These guys will sometimes give you health back at least. So at this point in the game, the power-ups will actually start giving you a gray option. That will actually downgrade you, so you definitely don't want to do that. Really need some health. Alright, there's a little bit. Oh, we just got downgraded. Ugh. Dead again. Yeah, so this is what happens when you're not fully powered up on this level. It's really, really difficult. And not really in a good way. Not in a good way. Yeah, it's actually interesting. I've never had this much trouble with this final level in the past, and it's just because I never get here downgraded in power-ups. So that really makes all the difference. Slowly getting back up to snuff. It's nice they're actually giving me power-ups that change this time. In the first section, they weren't. And that was also one of the problems. One of the things I was having trouble with. Alright, this should do it. Alright, we're maxed out again, finally. Never in my life have I ever had to play so safe on this stage. It's actually kind of weird having to do that. Oh, I still got hit. So Batman basically ran over on his own as an automated thing, and I still got hit. Yeah, this part is tough too, because these dudes do a ton of damage. But they do drop a little bit of health. So if you've got the spread shot, it's best to just get up and point blank. I think this is actually the final section, and then we pretty much go to the final boss. So switching your attack is actually a little tricky on this section. It's not the most responsive thing in the world. Alright, still making pretty good progress. We haven't taken too much damage, and when we have, we've gotten quite a bit of our health back. So we're currently sitting at full health right now. I wasn't able to switch over as fast as I wanted to, so I had to use that skull. I wanted to save it. Ended up picking up the green shot too. Wasn't planning on that, but yeah, I really feel like the red shot is the best now. If you get up close, you can kill enemies the fastest. Going to die again. Thing is, these ball things are really tough to deal with. They're a lot more aggressive on the final boss fight. I feel like I wouldn't have had this problem if I didn't accidentally switch over to the green power-up. I know I'm making excuses, but I really feel like I'm underpowered now. Well, especially after losing my firepower, since I died. Dying is bad. Looks like you can sort of get behind this guy, too. And it wouldn't be as bad if you could switch faster. Like, I'm having a really hard time switching directions. Like, Batman feels very unresponsive on this jetpack thing. Oh, great, I switch over to the red one. Now's probably not the best time for that. Yeah, we're definitely not gonna make this. Yep, game over. So actually, what I could have done is I could have used a bit of a cheat. I think I could have put the controller into the controller 2 port and then brought out Robin. Oh, look at this. It actually spawns me here. That's good. Let's see if we can do this. I don't think we're going to be able to. But if we can get fully powered up again. What I was going to do is just use the level cheat. level skip cheat to show you how that works. It's pretty easy to remember in this game. I'm so underpowered right now. Now, one of the shames about riding on this jetpack is that apparently you can't punch anymore. Alright, I want to get this guy over in case he drops a weapon power-up. Nope, no weapon power-ups yet. Come on, game, leave me some weapons. Nope, no weapons. Still no weapons. I know there were a lot of weapon drops right before the boss fight the first time. Well, there's one. But I didn't want to pick that up. I wanted the red so I can actually upgrade myself. As it stands, I basically just swapped over. Alright, there's another one. Dude, it's going all the way across the screen. Makes it, like, impossible to dodge. Oh, still so low on health. far from maxed out. It's like I need to focus on these spinning balls because they give me a little bit of health back, which I'm not doing a very good job at actually picking up. This is going to be really problematic now. It actually gave me a weapon power up. I'm surprised by that. There's another one. It's not switching though. I don't want it. I need health more than anything right now. I need to stay away. Oh, shoot. Come on, Batman, switch over, dude. Yeah, it's the biggest problem with this jetpack is it's so laggy to switch sides. Alright, I think that's it. Wow. Right down to the wire. That was close. You know, I wasn't expecting to have to continue to begin with, but I also wasn't expecting to have trouble at the very first part of the final stage. So that took us probably about 10 or 15 minutes longer than it should have. But I'm glad we were able to do it with, you know, recovering like that. I wasn't expecting to have to recover, but I'm glad we were able to. And if it shot me back to the very beginning of that final stage, I think I would have just used the level cheat to get back to the final boss. But not having any weapon power-ups would have been problematic for us. So there you go, guys. That is The Adventures of Batman and Robin for the Sega Genesis. If any of you guys are new to my channel, within the last couple of years, I hope you guys enjoyed this Let's Play. Again, this is basically a re-record of one of my earliest Let's Plays I've ever done. And I plan on revisiting many of those early Let's Plays Pretty much anything up until when I got the Framemeister, which was about a year ago, I'm going to be doing re-records of, so I can basically have the highest quality, visually speaking anyway, Let's Plays on my channel that I possibly can. And like I said at the very beginning of the video, it also gives you guys that are potentially newer to my channel, you know, access to some of these old videos that maybe you missed out on. I mean, maybe you discovered me through those old videos, but chances are I'm going to say probably not. And so it gives you guys a chance to see me play through these games again in a dedicated Let's Play format. So expect more of that in the future. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this Let's Play. Not really a whole lot else to talk about. I think I've pretty much talked about everything there is to talk about in this game in terms of gameplay. And like I said, it's a really fun game. I do recommend trying it. I think it's quite a solid, you know, relatively late release Genesis game. Visually, it's amazing for the system. It's easily one of the best looking games on the console. I mean, not only are a lot of the visual effects great, but the animation is fantastic in this game. Everything animates very fluidly. And even with still images like this right here, you know, just the way the art style comes off, it's just... it's very, very nice looking. Even like the still images look good. It's not just the animated stuff. It looks great in this game. It also sounds fantastic too. It's got a soundtrack, a very heavy electronic soundtrack that you wouldn't expect to work with the a Batman game, but it actually fits this game quite well. I can't imagine this game with a different soundtrack. So, yeah, that's pretty much it, guys. I'm gonna go ahead and wrap it up here. I want to say thanks again for watching. If you are brand new to my channel and you happen to stumble upon this video, please consider subscribing. I've got a ton of Let's Plays on this channel, and as you can probably tell, many, many more to come. To everybody else already subbed, thanks as usual for your continued support. Hope you guys continue to enjoy these videos, and I'll see you soon. So, until the next video, take it easy.